Good evening. Today is Monday, February 1st, 2016. We're here for the purpose of the regular meeting of the city of, pardon me. Let me try that again. Thanks, Dan. Good evening. Today is Monday, February 1st, 2016. I'd like to call this meeting to order. We're here for the purpose of the regular meeting of the Elmhurst City Council. It is 7:45. I would ask that you all rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, Clerk Spencer, I ask you to call a roll.
Deuter.
Here.
Sabatino. Leader absent. Dunn.
Here.
Graham.
Here.
Palumski.
Here.
York.
Here.
Toledo.
Here.
Healy.
Here.
Levin.
Here.
Kennedy.
Here.
Honquist.
Here.
Wagner.
Here.
Mulliner.
Here.
13 present, 1 absent.
13 present, 1 absent. We have a quorum. On with the agenda. Agenda item number 3, receipt of written communications. At this time, is there anyone in the audience who has any written communications they wish to submit to Clerk Spencer? Please raise your hand if you have any written communications. Seeing none, we'll move on. Public forum, agenda item 4. This is a part of our meeting where anyone in the audience can address the council on any topic they so choose. We ask that you keep your comments to 3 minutes. If you run over 3 minutes, I'll give you a gentle reminder and ask you to wrap up. We do ask you that you keep your comments to 3 minutes out of respect for the work that we have to do here this evening, but also out of respect for folks, the other folks who may want to speak. When you are recognized, I ask that you approach this microphone over here to my right. Clerk Spencer, do we have anybody who has signed up for public forum this evening?
Yes, we do. I'll start with Claude Pada. Let me do that over again. Claude Pagosh, 566 West Gladys.
Claude Pagosh, 566 West Gladys. I understand and have read about the meeting that was held about the state of Elmhurst, city of Elmhurst. I agree with part of it. The individual that represented the Chamber of Commerce was right. This council has been beneficial to him. Set up a TIF all the way down York. $350,000 is given away at the Elmhurst, old Elmhurst Hospital, where they're building row houses. Very nice. Public paid for the garage, new 6 stories. And then our partners came along and said, what's another $89,000? They got it. Superior got a piece of street, and now we got the hardware store. Public land again. I'll give it to them. Why is it that all public land that you oversee is worthless? And don't, please don't, accept another dollar from me. If you're going to give it away, give it away. Don't dance with it's only worth a dollar. Just give the land away, it's worthless. And I would ask the city manager, I would like a letter. The city council has stated numerous times that the land in Elmhurst is absolutely worth nothing. They've given public land away time and time again. So I'd like a letter from them so I can go to the assessor and I can tell him that the council has said that there is no land that is worth anything in the city of Elmhurst. And I'm tired of paying taxes on it. So I'd appreciate that letter. One other thing. You got on the agenda 616. I hope you all really understand what that means and what it is. And that it also applies to residential, commercial, and industrial projects. Because if you vote it in, I think it'll be one big mistake. So really ask what you're voting on. Forget about committees. Understand what it is, because it's a dramatic change, unless you understand what you're voting on.
Mr. Pagas, could you wrap your comments up, please?
Surely. I'd like that letter, Mayor.
Kathleen Sullivan.
I don't want a dollar anymore.
On Friday, February 19th, Elmhurst Panhellenic will be hosting their Wild for Fashion 2016 fashion show to raise funds to educate Elmhurst women. Thank you.
That concludes public forum and the sign-ins.
So that concludes public forum for the folks who have signed in. At this time, is there anybody who did not have an opportunity to sign in our sign-in sheet but wishes to address the council? Can I see a show of hands? Okay, we'll go left to right. I see two folks. Mr. Crumry, we'll start with you.
Michael Crumry, 570 West Crockett. A couple of administrative things. Would request that meeting minutes from the council meetings, or I'm sorry, the committee meetings, be posted within 2 business days. Reason for that is during the January 19th City Council meeting, the agenda included items from the January 11th Public Works Building Committee, yet the notes from that meeting had not been posted. And then I certainly hope that the agenda tonight does not include anything from the January 25th FCAAS or Public Works Committees, since the minutes from their respective meetings from last week are not yet posted. The other topic on the agenda here is the York Commons, and there's an attachment letter from the Park District as well as a response from V3. Thought about doing a card trick for you guys here, but I'll just read their sleight of hand paragraph here. So paragraph 3, is the installation of a shutoff valve a necessity for this project? Rather than read the whole paragraph, I'll read the first and last sentence. Based on the tables provided by Burke Engineering, et cetera, no valve scenario demonstrates an increase 500-year discharge, which occurs through the overflow weir, et cetera. Then the last sentence says, the shutoff valve would prevent this overflow and maintain existing conditions at Crescent Street for storms exceeding the 100-year event. So the first paragraph talks 500, the last paragraph says 100. So my question, or really discussion point, is to explain why the data and the discussion even includes a 500-year event. Why not 100-year, 200-year, 300-year? A 500-year event, statistically, how can it even be mapped out? So, you know, as a resident and as a person attending many of these flood meetings, people begging, pleading for something to occur, it appears that this 500-year event is kind of what's being used to say that the valve is needed. So I'd recommend that maybe redo the numbers, do a 200-300-year event. If the Park District wants to go on the path, okay, well, let's do a 750-year event. Let's do a NOAA event. I mean, how far are we going to go with this? Last thing then is on January 19th, the last city council meeting, unfortunately there was something offensive that was said at the conclusion of a resident when they were speaking. So I'd like to ask who said that comment and when will the apology be forthcoming? So the following individuals are excluded from answering this question tonight. Alderman Sabatino, Dunn, Healy, and Honquist, because they were absent from that meeting, as well as any female officials that are up there, they're excluded from answering that question. So at this point, I allow for the chairman to acknowledge the person to answer that question. So who said, and let me get the phrase here, "What an ass," is what was said. So, Mr. Chairman, can you provide an answer to that question?
Mr. Kremer, you're aware this is public forum, not Q&A, so.
Okay, well, I'm asking for an answer. You have the authority to direct answering that question or direct the person to answer that question?
I just ask you to wrap up your comments, Mr. Kremer.
Okay, and I'll step away from the microphone once that individual acknowledges and provides an apology, sir.
Mr. Kremer, we have a meeting to conduct here, so I would ask that you conclude your comments and wrap up.
I will conclude the comments as soon as someone acknowledges that issue, sir.
Well, that's not going to happen, Mr. Kremer.
Okay, well, you're going to have to go your option of clearing the room. That was your last choice when you and I had this discussion.
Just move on with the agenda. Mr. Mayor, point of order, can we just move on with the agenda? I think public comment has been concluded.
Actually, no, we have one more person who wants to speak.
All right.
Oh. What? Does this microphone here work? All right.
So the person that said that is not man enough to provide an apology to taxpayers, residents of Elmhurst, when that particular resident is always talking about taxes and the Elmhurst residents being overburdened, but then they are treated with such disrespect and unprofessionalism is unconscionable.
Okay, anyone else who wishes to address the council? This man in the front here with the glasses? Same thing, please identify yourself.
You can raise the mic a little bit here. My name is Brad Fitzpatrick. My wife and my two young daughters live at 323 East Huntington Lane in Elmhurst. I'm here to address a ongoing flooding problem that we've had since we moved here into town. My family and I moved into the area at about summer or fall of 2012. A few months after that, as we all probably remember, the spring of 2013, there was a pretty significant rain event that happened. At that point, our basement was fairly ruined with numerous feet of water in the basement at that point. At that point, I realized I was welcome to Elmhurst with water in my basement and soon approached the city engineers with this issue. At that point, the city engineers designed and put a drainage plan together for my yard. They put me in touch with a recommended contractor, and at that point, I paid about $7,000 for this plan to be executed and done. Since that point, our basement has flooded two more times, substantially damaging property, and obviously it's proven that what they designed and put together was not successful. And really, at the end of the day, the main issue becomes our house was built before a lot of the other houses around us. Therefore, there's probably five houses that drain directly into our yard. So the runoff, when we get a large rain event, eventually ends in my basement. The issue I have is the lack of, I guess, taking ownership and accountability for designing a plan to prevent flooding and it's still happening. As some of us know, insurance doesn't cover flooding, doesn't cover your property during flooding if it's coming through your window wells. So there's been a pretty significant financial loss from our perspective with regards to that. The reason why I'm here this evening is really just to bring this issue out in hopes of getting some more empathy and really, quite frankly, urgency from the city in helping us get this issue resolved. I've been more than willing to try and to work with them to get this fixed, and it's been more about them telling me things that I cannot do rather than coming together and partnering with me to figure out what I can do to get this problem done. Thanks.
Thank you. Okay, anyone else? Seeing none, that concludes our public forum portion of the meeting. Any announcements from the dais? Agenda item 5. Seeing none, we'll move on to the consent agenda. At this time, is there any item on the consent agenda that any alderman wishes to have removed to vote no or provide additional comment? Alderman Levin.
6.16.
6.16, Clerk Spencer. 6.16. Anything else? Seeing none, I will now entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda minus item 6.16. Motion to approve. Motion by Alderman Wagner, second by Alderman Bram. Clerk Spencer.
Wagner.
Aye.
Bram.
Aye.
Kalumski.
Aye.
York.
Aye.
Toledo.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Levin.
Aye.
Kennedy.
Aye.
Honquist.
Aye.
Milliner.
Aye.
Deuter.
Aye.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader. Absent. Dunn.
Aye.
13 ayes, 0 nays, 1 absent.
13 ayes, 0 nays. Motion carries. Agenda item, consent agenda minus item 6.16 passes. On to agenda item 6.16. Clerk Spencer, I'd ask that you read the recommendation.
Therefore, the Development Planning and Zoning Committee recommends that the City Council approve the adoption of the plumbing code amendment herein. The city attorney is hereby directed to prepare the necessary documents for City Council approval. Signed by Scott M. Levin, Chairman, Mark A. Mulliner, Vice Chairman, Michael Honquist.
Okay, to put this before council, I will ask for a motion to approve the report and recommendation as read.
Mr. Mayor, upon the request of myself and Alderman Bram, we'd like to have it deferred under 206HH till the next meeting.
To the next meeting? Do I have to vote on that, Don, or is that just?
No, I think
it's upon the request of any two aldermen.
Okay, all right. So part of our code,
I didn't hear
with a report, not a resolution, but a report. Two aldermen can request to have it pushed to the next meeting, and we'll do that.
Thank you, Mayor.
All right. On to committee reports. Give me a second to catch up to the paperwork. Agenda item 7.1. It's a report out of Public Affairs. Clerk Spencer, I'd ask that you read the recommendation.
It is therefore the recommendation of the Public Affairs and Safety Committee that the council approve the emergency traffic control plan and the city manager be authorized to approve the purchase of equipment / materials. Signed by Chris Healy, Chairman, Danny Palumski, Vice Chairman, Norm Leader.
Okay, to put this before council, I will ask for a motion to approve the report and recommendation as read. Motion by Alderman Healy, second by Alderman Palumski. Alderman Healy, your report.
Thank you, Mayor. Well, this is a topic that many of us know is another issue that plagues the city when we have significant storm events in town, traffic around town, in every area of town that's affected by flooding, and even many areas that aren't. Gets very congested, it gets snaggled, it gets problematic. So we as a committee attempted to look at dealing with some of those problems in order to alleviate them. And what we quickly found out was that there are many, many challenges to doing that. And we actually tried to bite off more than we could chew. So after a couple of meetings, we started to narrow the focus. And we narrowed them to the two areas where we've got a considerable amount of traffic and that are directly impacted by flooding, those being North Avenue, eastbound at the 294 underpass, and then, of course, the Schiller underpass. And even once we narrowed the focus down to those two areas, we had considerable issues, and staff worked very hard, the public safety divisions of police and fire and then public works, to try to come up with some plan that helped manage the crush of traffic that exists in those two areas, that staff was able to adequately and properly address in a timely fashion. One of the areas that quickly became apparent to us was that the public safety guys and men and women have their hands full, obviously. They're dealing with life safety issues. So to get them, to ask them to take on incremental responsibility with traffic management, more so than the police already do, was problematic for us. So then, of course, Public Works came into it, and we asked Public Works to come up with a plan, but we also found out very quickly that they become very burdened very quickly when we get a large storm event. So we asked them to think outside the box, and what they came back with is what you see in the report. A storm team that is dedicated to closing off areas of town that are directly impacted by flooding, again, North Avenue and Chill Underpass, and then try to direct traffic in a way that makes sense and that's open. Now, if you think about flooding and the storm events, not every storm is the same. Different areas of town get hit harder than others, so it's kind of a fluid situation and one that calls for a person or a team that has the responsibility for trying to manage the situation. So that's what the storm team is. Staff worked very hard on this. We pushed them very hard, got input from a lot of aldermen. We felt it was important enough to make it a report on its own, so give the council a chance to discuss. But we're happy with the outcome. A couple of comments about what the report isn't. And again, going back to how we started, we tried to take a comprehensive look at the city of Elmhurst because there are, I don't know, 17 of us sitting on the council. Every one of us could come up with three or four intersections that are really impacted when it floods. We tried to address as many, or we looked at addressing as many as we could, and logistically it just isn't possible. So we narrowed the focus to these two. Our commitment and staff's commitment is and will be to continue to continuously look at and tweak this plan. Hopefully we don't have to implement it, but realistically we know we probably will, and that as we implement the plan, we will take a look at it and tweak as necessary. We will add intersections or areas of town that we might be able to impact, knowing the challenges that are out there. But it was difficult and it was a challenge, and we're going to start here and work it out from there. Finally, I would say that there is a big communication piece to this that staff is still working on. Communication manager Schreff is still working on how we can get information to the residents when we start to implement the traffic plan. So when we close North Avenue, how can we get information to not only the residents, but other people that are using North Avenue or trying to get through Schiller? Social media, obviously, but also some of the Wayfinder apps, Waze and Google Maps and all that. Those are areas that we're looking at and are pursuing to try to get the information out, because it's one thing to close the street, it's another thing to do something with the traffic that we will try to implement as we further build out the policy. So with that, I'll open it up and take any questions.
Alderman York.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'd like to thank the Public Affairs and Safety Committee, and specifically Alderman Healy and city staff, for their work in putting together this plan to deal with, as Alderman Healy said, the inevitable street closures that occur during heavy rain periods, specifically at the I-290 underpass. As this primarily affects the 4th Ward and parts of the 3rd Ward, this will make a huge difference in the neighborhoods bordered by North Avenue, York Street, the Union Pacific Railroad, and I-290, and that will keep traffic seeking a non-existent route to areas east of I-290 out of those neighborhoods in their endless quest of a circular and impossible passage. So thank you on behalf of the 4th Ward.
Alderman Levin.
Two questions. One is, there is a component besides the other two that deals with a program for caution tape in the neighborhoods. Is that part of this plan, it seems?
That actually exists already, that a resident can call up City Hall and request caution tape. So we're going to expand that, make that plan a little more well known. But yeah, absolutely, that's part of it.
All right.
But that exists currently. So that I didn't mean to brush over that, but that we provide that now.
All right. And I understand the Palmer Drive portion. The part I'm a little confused on is the north Avenue one, because in the storm of 2013, there was gridlock because traffic, including truck traffic, was exiting 290, heading in towards the city and coming down North Ave, York Street to take a left on North. And now, if the underpass is closed, and if 290 heading east is closed, it just seems like we've created a different gridlock. And I don't know if that's something that was, I don't see how it works on the plan, I guess.
Alderman Healy.
Well, I mean, that's a great example, and quite honestly, one of the examples that staff used when raising a concern about trying to implement a traffic plan. The reality of the situation is those streets are going to close if an event occurs on the north side of town and the 294 underpass at North Avenue closes. Those situations are going to exist anyway. We're trying to be proactive in closing some of these routes so that semis in particular don't end up in areas where they can't go anywhere, or worse, and this we know of at least two examples where this happened, where the semis tried to head into a residential neighborhood to try to get out. Don't want to suggest that this plan is perfect or that there won't be situations where problems occur, but what we're trying to do here is be proactive to stop a situation like that, get the storm team to close off the right streets, and then to encourage traffic to go in an area where we know they can get out, as opposed to not closing off roads that we knew led to nowhere and having traffic end up in those areas. So it's going to be a continual thing, and we're relying on the people on the scene, not only public safety, but the public works people, to take the right measures to make sure we alleviate as much of that as possible, if that makes sense.
Just follow up. I mean, I think I commend you for undertaking this, and I will support it because it's not that big of a dollar amount, and it's buying equipment, so that if it doesn't work this way, it'll work another way. I just would say that there might be a need to put signage at the exit of 290 to tell the driver, particularly the semi drivers, when they get off, that they ought to stay back, just get right back on, because once they come into the town, the only way out would be to direct them west on North Avenue, and I think that also has to be part of the plan or something to think about. But I will support it, and I commend you for undertaking it.
And it certainly will be, and I would say the police did a very good job of explaining that even today, without this policy, they're trying to do those things anyway. But if we, through this policy, can give them additional support via Public Works to do that, we will. But that in a nutshell is why we're trying to create this team and provide them with the tools, is to be able to address those situations, because what we've seen firsthand is, in the absence of that kind of help, areas that are 3 feet underwater are don't want to see semis down their street, and we've had that.
I'm glad you described the problem as fluid.
Bad. Poor choice of words.
Alderman Bram.
Thank you. I also commend the committee for taking this on. I mean, I think it is something that we have to look at for the whole city of Elmhurst. I definitely agree, because traffic does get diverted into residential neighborhoods, and especially when it comes to commercial traffic, that leads to a larger issue. Robert Palmer Drive, I'm all on board for the segment of this report for Robert Palmer Drive underpass. I think it's a no-brainer from the standpoint of, preventing cars or any vehicles from getting stuck on that underpass. I do have some concerns over the North Avenue plan. I think first and foremost, I think it does need to be revised. From the standpoint of, I think that the barricade should actually be right at Robert Palmer, closer to the underpass, not blocking off any part of North Avenue nor any of the side streets, and I'll say why. One barricade, type 3 barricade that's on there on Berteau, if we close off North Avenue and close off Berteau, no residents could get to their house on Berteau, DuPage, or Melrose Avenue. It's a one-way in, one-way out. So we pretty much caused an issue for any of the residents on those 3/4 streets, on Berteau, DuPage Avenue, Melrose, because it was formerly known as the Berteau Jug Handle. It's a dead-end street at a cul-de-sac, and by blocking it off at North and York, and then on top of it, blocking it off at Berteau, I foresee residents who need to get there moving barricades, leaving them moved, moving barricades on North Avenue and York, as well as moving them at Berteau, and then it's wide open anyway. So I think there's definitely one revision to allow for residents to get to their own homes in a situation like this, because I'd hate for loved ones to have concerns, additional delays of not having their spouses or children coming home due to blocked streets by the city of Elmhurst. The other concern is this, and I relate this to when we get a parking request for our parking around schools and or parks in the city of Elmhurst. When you're around those entities, you should expect additional traffic. I think what happens when we start to put no parking around schools or limited parking or no parking around schools or parks, the problem just extends a little bit further away from that entity. Same thing here. If you're blocking it off in York and North, I foresee the problem still existing in the 3rd and 4th ward. They're just going to enter on different streets. They're going to enter, for example, for the 3rd ward on Columbia off of North Avenue. Instead of off of North Avenue, they're going to come off of York Road. Then it's going to even be worse because we have these barricades and they can't turn around. They're going to be trying to back up in residential driveways, and obviously tractor trailers are not meant to be backing up in residential driveways. So I think I would recommend a revision to this plan to really just barricade to the last residential street where the underpass is for 294, to allow residents to get to their homes and not do that balloon effect where you squeeze a balloon on one end and it blows up on the other end. That's the same thing that's gonna happen here. We might prevent one entrance way, but we're causing them to enter in a different way. I know if I was a driver trying to get home or trying to go east on North Avenue, and I'm about to turn onto North Avenue, either coming from the north or south, I'm gonna continue going north or south and turn on the first street possible. And it's gonna end up to be the same thing, if not worse, as I said. It would either spread or become worse where they can't turn around in the residential area. So at a bare minimum, I'd like to request that North Avenue is open at York Road, and Berteau should be open at the very minimum from the standpoint of allowing residents to get to their own homes and have more of the warning signs compared to the barricades blocking the whole street. Thank you.
Alderman Healy.
Just a couple points. This is not a hard and fast policy. So when an event occurs, the barricades just don't fly. They'll be pre-positioned, they'll be there, and then the storm team, in conjunction with police and fire, will make the proper decision on where to close and what streets to close, what not to close. The streets that are impacted by this will have Type 3 barricades, but they won't be completely shut. There will be enough room for residents to get through and emergency vehicles to get through. Now, of course, that means some other traffic is gonna get through too. We can't do anything about that. We can discourage, we can't really prohibit. And as I've said, this report is gonna be constantly changing. Some of the concerns raised in the dais are some of the same concerns raised by public staff. One of the benefits of being Elmhurst is we're right in the middle of everything. One of the problems with Elmhurst is we're right in the middle of everything. We can't do anything about the traffic, it's going to be here. So when we implement this policy, and again, I hope we don't have to, but when we do, staff, Public Works, the storm team, these dedicated storm team people will bring it back to us and we will make adjustments as needed. If we go back to where we started from, I think we'd all agree, particularly those in the 3rd and 4th ward off North Avenue, would agree we can't do nothing. That we've tried nothing and nothing doesn't work. Nothing ends up with semis going through neighborhoods, taking down street signs. This is our initial attempt to take care of that, or address that. I don't want to say take care of it, but address it. If something we've done causes a problem somewhere else, we'll address it and tweak as necessary. I think that's the important, that's one of the important things of this policy. That's one thing staff felt very strong about, is the ability to change and tweak as needed. And I think that's what this policy does. Again, it's a start, and we'll go from there, but I think it's a good start. I think it leaves the decision-making in the hands of the men and women that are on scene, that are best equipped to make the decisions, what streets to close, what streets not to close. And I think it's a little more proactive, and dedicates, more importantly, dedicates the resources. It would have been very easy for us just to tell staff, figure it out, do it with the manpower that you have now. There's budget dollars spent on equipment. There's going to be budget dollars spent on salary, incremental bodies on scene that will handle this situation, the policy as needed. I think that's the important thing to remember here. So I wouldn't be in support of making any amendments to the policy as written, but I am fully comfortable that staff, as the policy is implemented the first time, will come back to and say, here's how the policy needs to be adjusted.
Alderman Toledo.
Thank you, and thank you, Chairman Healy and the committee, and also staff for putting forth the effort to think through a plan that we can use in what I think is a very proactive way. Is it perfect? No, I agree. Is it something that we can learn from? Yes, and I think it's a great example of how we can work together to put in place something to solve, a plan to solve a problem that we know exists. And I think I can speak on behalf of all of the residents of the 4th Ward, especially on the north side of the 4th Ward, that this is a problem that we need to address. And I think this is a great first step towards doing that. And I think not only does it help to prevent some of the damage to property and potential safety issues with people coming into those areas of the neighborhood, that there is no, they don't know, but we know, that there is no exit from those areas when they try to go east through that neighborhood. There is not an exit, which leads to the problem. So this will help with that, but it also helps, and I think a couple of folks in the audience that spoke tonight understand that when we have these severe events and we have this kind of flooding, we have a big problem starts on the streets. And I've heard from folks speaking at public comment that when we get this traffic trying to get through on the commute home, they don't understand what they're doing, they don't understand what's going on, they're driving 30 miles an hour down through flooded streets, and sometimes those couple inches of that wake caused by that car is what makes the difference between that water getting over into someone's home versus staying outside and keeping down below the foundation. So I think that in addition to all of the other reasons, is another great reason to try to limit the amount of traffic coming through these neighborhoods during these storm events. So I do thank you on behalf of the residents. I think this is a proactive policy. It's one that we will learn from over time, and I fully support it. Thank you.
Alderman Plumsky.
Thank you, Mayor. I also want to thank staff for taking a lot of time looking at this. I know this isn't something that we could really look to other communities to guide us in this, and it took a lot of time and effort, and thank you to Chairman Healy for pushing this forward. I think a key here is that these two areas also do not have projects currently planned to alleviate the flooding, where maybe there are other areas in town in which once some projects are underway, they will not be affected as much during heavy rainfall events. What this plan really does is it dedicates resources, it looks to staff to manage the situation as required by the storm, and it most importantly allows for adjustment as necessary. So I fully support this report. Thank you.
Alderman Bram.
Thank you. And I think, like I said initially, I thank the staff as well as the committee for looking into this, because I think this is difficult to resolve. My concerns earlier were made public. I just want to, I guess, air one additional concern. And there is a project for this slated for this year. It won't be done until towards the end of the year, according to the current schedule. But my concern is that when York Road further north floods, what always happens is they go in the residential off York Road, they go down Lake Street frontage onto Emory, And in this current plan, to get to North Avenue, on this current plan, there is a Type 3 barricade. And these are tractor trailers, a good majority. I've been out there. I've been on Lake Street frontage, jumping on the cabs, telling them that they're going nowhere, get out of the residential neighborhood. This is causing great concern. We're going to have a stacking at Emroy over the 290 overpass with these tractor trailers going to pretty much nowhere. I just wanted to throw that out there for the committee as well for staff to note both of the concerns that I have on this current plan because I foresee with the current barricade system, if there's enough gap for residents to get around, there's definitely going to be enough gap for non-residents to get around, and we're going to potentially see greater traffic in more areas. Thank you.
Any final comments? Seeing none, I ask Clerk Spencer to please call the roll.
Healy.
Aye.
Polumsky.
Aye.
York.
Aye.
Toledo.
Aye.
Levin.
Aye.
Kennedy.
Aye.
Onquist.
Aye.
Wagner.
Aye.
Deuter.
Aye.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader absent. Dunn.
Aye.
Graham.
Aye.
Did I? Oh, I didn't get Mulliner. Sorry.
Aye.
Thank you. 13 ayes, 0 nays, 1 absent.
13 ayes, 0 nays, motion carries. Agenda item 7.1 is approved. On to agenda item 7.2. Report out of Finance. Clerk Spencer, I'd ask that you please read the recommendation.
It is therefore the recommendation of the Finance, Council Affairs, and Administrative Services Committee that the City Council direct City Attorney to prepare the appropriate documents to establish a TIF incentive agreement and sales tax incentive agreement with Wilkins Buick Inc. doing business as Wilkins Hyundai Mazda as outlined in this report. Signed by Kevin L. York, Chairman, Bob Dunn, Vice Chairman, Noel P. Toledo, and Mark P. Sabatino.
Okay, to put this before council, I'll ask for a motion to approve the report and recommendation is read. Motion by Alderman York, second by Alderman Dunn. Alderman York.
Thank you, Your Honor. Tonight, the committee presents a twofold incentive proposal for Wilkins Auto Dealership. They have a different legal name, but that's what we'll call it to keep it simple up here tonight, which currently houses Hyundai and Mazda dealerships in the same showroom on North York Road here in Elmhurst. Wilkins is proposing making an investment of over $7 million in Elmhurst in 2016, which will also lead to more jobs and more taxable auto sales. First of all, I'd like to thank this committee, Mike Kopp and Marilyn Gaston and their staff, for all of your hard work on behalf of the taxpayers of Elmhurst and the applicant. This particular application took a lot of time and a lot of collaboration with the applicant to finally get all the pieces of the puzzle laid out so that we could fully grasp the entirety of the situation and the requests. As we all know, retail sales tax is a major component of the revenue stream for Elmhurst and its stakeholders, and one that when it's growing takes pressure off the need to look for revenue elsewhere. This has recently allowed us to provide meaningful relief on the property taxes here in Elmhurst. We also understand what TIF districts are put in place to accomplish, and as I said in one of our committee meetings, all development is good development at the end of the day. So I'd like to quickly elaborate on a couple points regarding the TIF incentive. The Wilkins folks initially applied for 100% of the TIF increment that could be generated on their improved property amounting to about $700,000. As I explained, and the committee agrees, and I think most of you up on the dais would also agree, TIF increment is supposed to be used for redevelopment in general within the entire TIF area, not only for a specific development. With that being said, I believe the recommendation made in the report is right on track and recognizes both the investment that the applicant will make on their own behalf, but also recognizes the benefits of the stormwater improvements that we'll have on the system as a whole. The other thing that is deserving of consideration is the fact that we have IGAs with other taxing bodies that share revenue with them starting in year 11 of TIF 4. And as such, that IGA will be an integral component of our calculation of TIF increment going forward, as we contemplate any TIF incentives. In the case of Wilkins, the TIF incentive of $300,000 that we're recommending represents about one quarter of the net TIF increment that will be generated throughout the life of TIF 4 and is very comparable to other TIF incentives granted in TIF 4 to date. Payments, just to remind everybody, will be made on an annual rebate beginning with the collection of the 2017 property taxes. Before we dive into the sales tax incentive, and this is a point that the committee requested from Mr. Wilkins very specifically, we needed a clear understanding of exactly what it would take to make this project happen, and probably even more importantly, what would be the consequences to the city if the project doesn't happen. The Wilkins folks answered the how much question, and city staff has verified with Mr. Wilkins and Mazda on the what if question. The financial gap for this project was pegged at $1.8 million, down from the initial would be nice to have ask of $3.2 million. And most importantly, if this project does not move forward, Mazda, the car company, would use its buyback provision in the franchise agreement to take the Mazda dealership from the Wilkins, and Wilkins would then use those buyback proceeds to finance the construction of a new Hyundai showroom and move on down the road. It's very likely, if not almost certain, the Mazda dealership would not be in Elmhurst. The city, as noted in the report, would lose its share of taxes on about $250 million in gross sales over just the next 10 years. So Elmhurst would be looking to make up about $2.5 million in revenue just in the next 10 years, to be perfectly clear. As the council can see on the sales tax incentive summary that was posted on Board Docs, and it has been for all of our committee meetings as well, Wilkins has a current sales tax incentive agreement with the city that was used to bring, specifically to bring the Mazda dealership to Elmhurst in 2008 and make available the land to do the showroom separation at some point in the future. This current agreement, which is referenced in our committee's report, is over at the end of 2018 and does not contain a clawback provision. Clawback provisions are currently part of all of our incentive policies and agreements and have been since 2009 when Storino, Romello, and Durkin became our city attorneys. Since financial gap was identified at $1.8 million and we have a proposed TIF incentive of $300,000, the sales tax incentive required to move this project forward for financing is $1.5 million, and that is what you have before you tonight. The committee recognizing that having an agreement of this size is certainly a long-term investment, recommends that we move forward with a 15-year agreement. And not only will that lock Wilkins into the community, but it will also give Wilkins the ability to satisfy its lenders with the ability, especially given the cyclical nature of auto sales, to more than likely earn the full incentive, which will provide the needed stability for the financing of this project. The sales tax incentive, as indicated in the report, will be capped at $1.5 million in total, beginning with the quarterly payments that are made on sales taxes, submitted starting on April 1st, 2016, through December 2016 under the prior agreement, and then shift to annual payments of sales taxes submitted beginning January 1st, 2017, through to the end of the agreement in time, or until the sales tax payments, rebate payments, equal $1.5 million under both agreements, starting with payments made for the period of April 1st, 2016. The splits between the city and the applicant are enumerated in the report and are favorable when compared to the existing agreement, but also provide the applicant the cash flow required to make the project happen from a financing perspective. At this time, I'd like to make a motion, Mr. Chair, to amend the report that is in front of everyone on the dais this evening. The report recommendation does not change, but changes within the report are clearly indicated with additions and strike-throughs, and it would be my pleasure to accommodate the chair in getting this accomplished in the most expedient fashion. So, Mr. Chair.
Well, motion to amend, And I will compliment Alderman York on actually submitting the motion to amend in writing, which is rare but much appreciated.
Thank you.
I assume everyone on the council has a copy of the amended report. Let's just put it this way. You have a motion to amend as indicated in writing in front of everyone, and I'll entertain a second before Alderman York goes into further explanation. Motion to amend by Alderman York, second by Alderman Dunn. Alderman York?
Thank you.
It's your motion to amend.
Thank you. I'll take just a couple minutes to kind of walk through. On page two, about in the middle of the page, on the TIF incentive request, it's a 15-year duration, and for some reason we had omitted the beginning in 2017, so that one should be pretty straightforward for everybody. And I'll go through them all, and then I'll take questions, or other folks on the committee can take questions as well. The next amendment occurs on page three. At the top of the page, in the addition of on December 31st, 2016, is the addition, and the deletion is the new agreement will have an effective date of April 1st, 2016, and the existing agreement will be terminated on that same date. The incentive that's currently in place, it was put in 2008. I wasn't on council then, and don't know what all the discussions were, but it was kind of peculiar in that this was one agreement where settlement was made on a quarterly basis versus an annual basis, and so that's kind of driving this. The other factor is that Wilkins is if this goes forward, is going to make this investment, and so basically the site will be under construction all of 2016 as they demolish a showroom and build two new showrooms and everything. So sales, while automobile sales are good, better than good in some cases, we certainly expect that this might be a hindrance to their ability to sell cars for 2016. So with that in mind, basically what this change does is it allows for the quarterly payments based on the old agreement to go forward as is structured in the old agreement until such time at the end of the year when the key is turned on the new showrooms and they'll start producing the new increased sales. That's when the new agreement would kick in with a higher taxable base. But what this does in the meantime is provides a better cash flow, but it still does not exceed the total sales tax incentive of $1.5 million over the course of the 15 years, or the $1.5 million, whichever occurs first. So this was a concern that the committee did discuss and is aware of. So that's kind of the explanation around that. The next change is an addition, maximum total sales tax incentive at this location of $1.5 million beginning April 1st of 2016. That's when the meter starts running on the total. Sales tax increment over the 2016 actual base year sales tax, and that's a number that Marilyn Gaston, Director of Finance, will provide, and we will get that number described with the help of Storino's firm. We'll get that number described in an RDA so that we have that number to go back and base as the base sales number, which now for part of the their sales tax incentive is zero in the Mazda because we were bringing that into the city at that time, and it's a smaller amount, a greater amount than zero on the Hyundai sales, but they'll all fall under one number. So that's the 2016 actual, highlight deleting the 2015. And as I noted earlier, to relieve an administrative burden on city staff as well as probably Wilkins folks, we'll be calculating and distributing the earned sales tax incentives on an annual basis beginning in January 1st of 2017. From that period, 2017 will be accumulated and distributed at some time in 2018 when it's known what the actual numbers are. So. How's that?
Thorough.
Thank you.
Alderman Deuter.
Thank you, Mayor. One of the questions I had as I looked over the proposed amendment
is, I guess it's the second to last bullet on page 2, where it talks about the base year. And
I'm sorry, what was that? Talks about what?
The base year.
Okay.
The proposed change is to delete 2015 as the base year and add 2016 as the base year.
And sure, you know, page 3.
That's page
3. Oh, I'm sorry.
The last page.
Right. Page 3.
Okay.
Sorry, I'm not thinking about the double-sided. So on page 3, you know, my concern, and I think Chairman York just mentioned that that there's a possibility that in 2016 sales might be lower than projected because of the construction underway. And I think, you know, it's best for the city if we keep that base as high so that the sales tax incentive actually reflects growth that's due to the improvements. I wonder if it might be based on their projections. They show their sales in 2016, they project that they'll be higher than 2015, which means it's great to use 2016 as a base year. But I wonder if we might not be better off saying 2015 or 2016, whichever is higher, as the base year.
Alderman York, care to respond?
I can only respond for me. I suppose we could do that. They're indicating a sales increase for the 2016, and regardless of what it is, I think it's probably really going to be a pretty small number, whichever way it is, whether it goes down a little bit or up a little bit from there. But I would say they're probably pretty close on their projections. It's certainly something that we could try and craft, if you know. But it's just going to even make it even more difficult then. But I'm sure attorneys can figure it out.
Alderman Levin.
I support the overall. I just have some questions I want to clarify in my mind as to how it works. Also on the last page 3. So the existing agreement terminates, the existing incentive terminates at the end of this year, correct?
No. I'm sorry.
I believe it's 2 years from now.
It's yes. Actually at the end of 2008.
Well, I mean, as proposed here, it would
yes.
terminate
yes.
at the end of this year.
Yes.
All right, so then the second change, it says the maximum total sales incentive at this location of $1.5 million begins April 1st. But isn't the incentive then in 2017 over 2016? In other words, you've got a base at 2016 of December 31, so you're going to calculate from December 31, 2016, and see how much more you have in 2017. Am I?
Yeah, you are, Your Honor.
Alderman York.
So there is a base in the old agreement, but it's zero for Mazda sales. And is it 40% over a number for the Hyundai sales? I'm looking out at Finance Director Gaston. In fact, I can pull it up, but it's a low number. It's a low number on the 2000 on the old agreement. It is a low number. So anything we can do to get there higher than that, there should go.
Well, I'm not questioning the number. I'm just looking at how the timing works because, you know, as I look at the three dates that are highlighted in the amendment, then it does say in the second to last highlight, sales tax increment over the 2016 actual base. Then it says the first payment's January 1st, 2017, but there couldn't be a payment.
No, that's when the sales start accruing from the 2017. The 2017 year will be paid in 2018.
But it says it'll be calculated annually on a pay-as-you-go basis beginning. So, you mean that's when the calculation, there's no payment?
That's right. That is correct.
All right, and then so the April 1st date, I guess, I that's the only one that's still not clear to me is if the base year is December 31, how does it begin? Or is that when you start calculating the base year?
You want City Manager Gaston, I'm City Manager. Sorry for the promotion. Finance Manager Gaston has a microphone. Would you like her to?
Yeah, if she
opine?
Could. Yes, if she could just clear the agreement as it pertains to the Hyundai sales. And the total sales reported of Wilkins, they break into a certain part Hyundai and a certain part Mazda. So if she could clear that up, I think that would be good information.
In the existing agreement, which was put in place at the end of 2008, Mazda was new, so there was zero base. Hyundai was an existing dealership, so their 2007 sales was the base for Hyundai. And that was the deal, that anything in e-sales tax over the 2000 base would be split 75 to Mr. Wilkins' firm, and then the rest to the city, 25% to the city. The situation was 2007 was a good year, but then every year after that, until most recent, it went downhill. So very little incentive was thrown off from Hyundai sales because the base was 2007. But it was a 75-25 split, but over a base that they very seldom reached until most recently. Their overall sales in the last 3 years, about 40% are Mazda, with 60% being Hyundai sales.
Alderman Levin, does that clarify your question, or do you have another question?
Well, how does that tie into the April 1st, 2016 date? Why is it April 1st as opposed, it looks like Alderman Toledo wants to.
You want Marilyn to answer that as well?
Alderman
Toledo wants to opine.
Actually, to answer the specific question that Alderman Levin has, because I had a similar question. So the maximum total sales incentive at this location of $1.5 million beginning April 1st, 2016, what that's meant to denote is that the April 1st, 2016 date is the start of the counter of the total sales tax that that property can earn, combining both the existing incentive, whatever they're going to earn between now and the end of December 2016, plus any new future when the new policy comes into effect. So it's the total amount that they can earn from April 1st, 2016 moving forward is capped at $1.5 million.
Well put, thank you.
Alderman Toledo.
Thank you. Now just my more general comments on behalf of myself and the committee. You know, I think a lot of this echoes what Chairman York said, but we all know car dealerships drive significant portions of revenue for our city. It does help us offset property taxes, or the city portion of property taxes for our residents here in town. I will tell you that I've had the pleasure to participate in a number of sales tax incentive requests at this point in time after a year and a half in this position, and this has been thoroughly reviewed. It became clear to me, and I believe my colleagues on the committee, that there was not only a demonstrated financial need for this project, but also that if the financial need wasn't met in order to move the project forward, that we would be losing the Mazda dealership here in town. So therefore, you know, the committee worked together on a TIF and a sales tax package to help meet that need and keep this important revenue source in town. The TIF is a part of that package, clearly identified TIF eligible expenses, stormwater improvements, as well as streetscape that I think is acknowledged and is in line. The applicant has acknowledged their awareness of the North York Corridor plan. They'll be putting in sidewalks there aligned with that plan, as well as safer ingress and egress to the dealership site as well. I think both of those are great improvements for the property. And then the sales tax incentive capped at $1.5 million, as I just described. And really, with the projected increase in sales at this site and the 15-year term that we negotiated into this deal, the incentive really, I feel, is a win-win, both for the taxpayers of Elmhurst long-term, as well as the applicant to upgrade their facility. So, thank you.
Alderman Wagner.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just a question for the chair. Do we have anything in writing from Mazda that says they absolutely will pull the franchise over to down the road?
Oh, absolutely. And Assistant City Manager Kopp worked closely with the applicant to make all this clear. So, and in fact, you know, the other thing that, you know, is worthy of note, this is great discussion tonight, but we're simply under the gun here. They've got to satisfy Mazda that they can pull this thing off here, but it's either March 1st or March 31st. I don't remember which one it is, but the deadline is looming. It's imminent at this point in time, and they've actually been kind of pushing them off a little bit here. These folks have made trips out here to see if they're serious about doing this, and they've so far been able to produce the renderings and the you know, drawings that they have and everything to convince Mazda that they're serious about this, because there are people who are interested in the dealership and taking it elsewhere if Wilkins doesn't perform as they have suggested that they would and as they've assured us that they would.
Alderman Bram.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I guess I didn't hear, I have a few things to say, from some of which some aldermen already asked questions. I'm not sure what the answer was. It's not clear to me. Alderman Wagner just asked, is something in writing? I understand that Assistant City Manager Kopp spoke with the representatives from Wilkins stating that, but the direct question was, is it in writing? I haven't heard an answer to that. Alderman Deuter made mention in regards to, on page 3, that second to last bullet point of the actual base year. I think it's a great one. And I think Alderman Chairman York concurred that it should be, or that he would consider it being either 2015 or 2016 actual base sales tax year. But I haven't heard anybody make a motion to either amend the current amendment that's on the table or a subsequent motion to amend it. Because I think that is in favor of the residents of Elmhurst. And Alderman York made mention that 2016, due to the construction, might be an off year. I mean, it's hard to look in any crystal ball to know, but with the construction, anybody would foresee that being a possibility. So I think that would be an amendment I would definitely support if anyone wants to so choose to move forward with that. Sales tax incentives and TIF incentives overall, and I'll take the liberty, since I've heard others speak past the amendment that's on the floor right now, I will do the same. I think they're difficult. I think they're difficult from the standpoint of, you know, the threat of any business leaving the city of Elmhurst is a scary proposition. And we have to balance that. We have to balance that from the dollars we have in TIF and the possible sales tax that we would receive from that business if they move forward with any type of upgrades to their business, be it structural or otherwise. You know, some of the sales tax, you know, incentive summary, reviewing that, we used to actually slant the sales tax incentives in favor of the city of Elmhurst residents. Then we went to a 50-50 split. Now it seems like our proposals are trending, I shouldn't say trending, they are trending to the perspective of the benefit to the business owner or the developer in either case. In this case, for the sales tax incentive, we're talking about a 75% to Wilkins and 25% to the city for the first 5 years. Then it's an even split at 50-50 for the next 7. And then it tilts to Wilkins or tilts to the city being 75% to the city and 25% for Wilkins for the final 3 years. Chairman York made mention during his statements that he feels from the numbers that were shown at the Finance Committee that more than likely they will earn the full incentive. In all due respect, that is not my goal to make sure, or, and I'm not making any assumptions or accusations that anybody on the dais is making sure that any business or proposal is intending to make sure they meet their incentive. I don't want it to come across that way. But I want to make sure that it is clear that it shouldn't be an effort of on our behalf to slant it to a way that they do have a greater possibility of meeting that sales tax incentive. It should be slanted in favor of the city of Elmhurst residents. I think at the greatest split for any sales tax incentive should be 50-50. Fair for the business, fair for the residents, and that's what everybody likes to throw around the term of a win-win. I always prefer slanted on behalf, be a little bit more conservative on the benefit of the city of Elmhurst taxpayers. So I would love to see the slant totally throughout the duration of this, as well as any sales tax incentive for the residents compared to any business or developer. Some of the past ones that we have done, I think it was Roche or Acura, one of them. It was a split similar, but it was, I think, for a 10-year time frame. This is for a 15-year time frame, so we're giving a longer duration to make sure they meet this incentive. Keep in mind, it was made mention that the total cost of this development is approximately $7 million. If they meet this full incentive, which, you know, looking at the crystal ball, Alderman York made a forecast of that they have a likelihood of doing so, that's 25% of their investment that the City of Elmhurst residents are picking up the tab for. To me, I think that's significant. I think, if anything, let them meet that 25%, sure. But it should be split the whole duration, 50-50. It shouldn't be split 75, any business, any developer, and then 25 for any duration, and therefore not benefiting the City of Elmhurst residents. And then on top of it, they're asking for a TIF incentive request, which is an additional $300,000, which is at a 50-50. Lastly, I'll say, yes, depending on what these amendments that, you know, we received on the dais before us this evening move forward, they being Wilkins in this case, be allowed to continue to collect sales tax incentive under their previous agreement. So even though they're doing the development this year, they're getting their full 15 years. Technically, the way I look at it is a full 16 years of a sales tax incentive, because they currently have an agreement and we're adding another 15 years to the agreement. I think this is too rich for my blood, with or without the amendment. I think the amendment is just that Alderman Deuter made mention of having it the greater of 2015 and 2016. But to see a 75% developer, 25% or business owner, 25% City of Elmhurst residents is not something I can support.
Alderman Levin.
I don't know about this one, but most TIFs that have the upfront weight in front of the business is because they're putting out the money. So we're not putting out any money. The business puts it out, and so it's kind of like the capital investors getting some of their repayment first. There is a win for the residents. We have quite a bit of sales tax. Anyone who's on the council knows that the majority of our sales tax comes from our car dealers, and protecting that investment is certainly good for the residents, so I can support this.
Alderman Dunn.
We talked about the level of TIF incentives and some of the splits that that's proposed here between the city and the applicant, and whether we're in favor of that or not. Looking at the history of sales tax incentives going back into the 90s, those incentives were in the $500,000 range, and they were 5 or 6 years. And then in the 2000s, in that decade, they escalated to $1 million, approximately in that range, and maybe went up 8 to 10 years for those particular incentives. Recently, because car dealers have been doing well, it's a very competitive environment, and as Alderman Toludo had mentioned, there has been quite a few run by us, and we review these very critically. The last few have been in the $1.5 million range, and we've been pushing that out the 15 years, not to make it easier for the applicant to earn that, but to for the city's well-being, to lock that applicant in for those extra years, because as Alderman York mentioned, there is a clawback provision in these agreements that if the applicant should leave prior to that, then they have to pay back all the incentive. So this, I was very critical of this particular application. It was a little bit confusing because it was the first time we had to deal with a joint TIF and sales tax incentive request. We haven't done that before. And so it took us a while to work through the calculations and review those and request updates and project costs and challenge the applicant on their numbers and run those again. The Wilkins Group indicated this particular project in their mind started out as a $3.3 million project a year or two ago when they just wanted to upgrade their facility. But with the advent of the requirements by Mazda to completely revamp their dealership, and as was mentioned, the need for stormwater mitigation, this project is expending $700,000 on stormwater mitigation. They can't even park in the back portion of their lot because of the fear. They've lost cars on several occasions, dozens of cars on several occasions. So they're going to put in a system that alleviates that, not only benefits them, but benefits those properties butting up against them. The showroom right now, I believe, is about 4,300 square feet. We're going to grow to 9,700 square feet Mazda dealer, 8,600 square feet Hyundai dealer. As was mentioned, the original cost was $3.3 million. It's escalated to a $7 million project because of the Mazda requirements and the streetscaping, the stormwater mitigation. The committee reviewed those elements, and the initial request was a combination TIF incentive and sales tax incentive. It was $3.2 million. And as Chairman York mentioned, through a lot of hard work and a lot of discussion, we really felt comfortable with that need being $1.8 million. And with the TIF being the $300,000, it made sense that the sales tax incentive would be that $1.5 million number. As far as the split goes, we've been utilizing a 75-25 split in the last few agreements, and that sounds a little bit out of whack, but early in the agreement, the amount of sales above the base is fairly small, so that 75% is not so big compared to years 5 through 10 or years 10 through 15, when the business, the entities performing well above that original base year. It's an excellent project for the region, for North York. We are gaining momentum there with some of the projects we have going on and that have already been conducted. This is going to add to it, and it's going to keep a very important organization in town. So I would ask you to support the report or the amended report. Thanks.
Okay, any additional comments? Alderman Deuter.
Thank you, Mayor. I appreciate the committee's work on this, and I support where they're headed, both with the original report and the report as amended, or as they're recommending to be amended. I would ask the chair if the appropriate way to suggest an amendment to what's being proposed to be amended is to do that now, or to wait until we've taken a vote on the proposed amendments that are in front of us now in writing.
Give me one second, Alderman. Deuter, I was just looking at that. Let's do amend motions. To amend shall be in order. It depends, and it's up to me if we want to split them up at a later time. But what, because technically a motion to amend in the second degree is allowed, but a motion to amend in the third degree is not. So that's my way of saying it is appropriate for you to make a motion to amend the current amendment if you want. if you want to wait, because if it passes or not passes, that then becomes the report. And if you want to make an additional amendment, that might make it cleaner. You can do it either way.
I'm happy to wait and make it cleaner. Thank you.
Okay. I'm happy that you're deciding to wait. Any other comments as it relates to this motion to amend? Alderman Bram.
Thank you. The way I foresee this, I see this moving forward. I would caution of waiting to make an amendment, a secondary amendment after the fact. One last comment, and it's in regards to the sales tax incentive agreement. Alderman Wagner made mention of, you know, what was in writing by the business owner. The sales tax agreement says that two of the three of these criteria must be met in order for it to be considered. And I've said this in the past and past agreements. Number one is desirable business that would address an underserved business segment. It's definitely a desirable business, underserved. We'll chalk that up to a yes. Number two, though, is presence of extraordinary development slash redevelopment costs, such as but not limited to, and it lists a variety of them. The key in that criteria is extraordinary. I hear on what they need, I hear on what it would cost, but I haven't heard that anything is extraordinary, like there's some additional circumstances that cost it to be above and beyond, where there's a storage tank underneath that they didn't know about, where there's cars beneath, I'm all in jest here, beneath the land where they wanted to build, and it's extraordinary development or redevelopment cost. And that does cover various things like the public infrastructure, stormwater retention, land acquisition, et cetera. But the problem I have anytime we talk about these agreements is that what defines extraordinary, and I never hear any discussion on what makes what's being proposed as extraordinary, because I don't think it is. It's the cost for them to do the development, sure. But is it extraordinary? You know, above and beyond, what is that baseline? I don't see it. I haven't heard it before. I haven't heard it tonight. The last one is quality of development and overall aesthetics that are in excess of the mandated legal requirements and design standards. Well, I don't think that one applies. So number one and two, to hit the criteria of a sales tax incentive, is a little bit tough to understand if that is met in this proposal. And then the question is, you know, sales tax incentive versus TIF incentive. TIF 4 is new. TIF 4 doesn't have hardly any dollars in it. Therefore, we need to supplement per the request with a sales tax incentive. That's why the TIF incentive request is low, because there's really nothing in TIF 4 to go after at this time. And I don't mean go after in a negative light. That's what it's there for. It is for a redevelopment. But due to the fact where TIF 4 is today, which I've been told that it's been pretty much stagnant, I mean, we have Mariano's on board, and we're going to have Han soon. But really past that, we haven't had any significant, and LA Fitness, significant development to see TIF 4 increase. We will very soon, but not to any degree. That's why we're seeing the sales tax and the TIF incentive. You know, I just want to make that clear to the public that there are two alternatives. This developer or business owner was smart to go about it in this way, because essentially TIF 4 doesn't have the funds to hit the $1.8 million that's being requested. 1.8, what was it?
Yes.
Yeah, 1.8 that's being requested at this time. Thank you.
Okay. Any other comments or questions? All right, vote as it relates to motion to amend, which is the revised report that's in front of you with the yellow highlights. Clerk Spencer, I'd ask that you call the roll.
York.
Aye.
Dunn.
Aye.
Bram.
No.
Belumsky.
Aye.
Toledo.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Levin.
Aye.
Kennedy.
Aye.
Onquist.
Aye.
Wagner.
Aye.
Milliner.
Aye.
Deuter.
Aye.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Okay, it looks like 12 ayes, 1 nay, 1 absent.
12 ayes, 1 nay. Motion to amend carries. So the report we will be considering is the amended report that's in front of us right now. Okay? Alderman Deuter, you potentially want to add comment or motion to amend this?
Yes. Yes. Thank you, Mayor. I would like to make a motion to amend page 3, the second to last bullet, And the language would be sales tax increment over the 2015 or 2016 base year, comma, whichever is higher.
All right, let me just make sure I got it. Motion to amend, second to last bullet on page three, sales tax increment over the 2015 or 2016 actual base year, whichever is higher.
Sales tax receipts, comma, whichever is higher.
Sales tax receipts, whichever is higher. So I had the whichever is higher in the wrong spot. Oh, I got it,
Mr. Chairman.
Good. Yeah, well, it's a motion. I can't, okay. Well, we can't comment to it.
Can I ask her a question about
no.
that?
No.
Okay.
Second first.
Okay.
Second.
So let me try that again. Motion to amend, second to last bullet, sales tax increment over the 2015 or 2016 actual base year sales tax receipts, whichever is higher. Yes?
Perhaps it would be simpler if we said the greater of 2015 or 26 year.
Perfect.
Actual base
sales
year.
Sales tax increment over.
Greater.
The greater of.
The greater of 2015 or 2016 actual
okay.
base year.
Actual sales.
Patty, do you understand that?
Yeah, I'm right.
Kevin, you make sure Patty has what we're talking about here?
I got it right here.
All right. Sales tax increment over the greater of 2015 or 2016 actual base year sales tax receipt will be split. Make sense? Everyone make sense? Motion, second. So that's a motion, second by Alderman Healy. All right, pretty self-explanatory. Alderman York, I'm sorry, you wanted to ask a question or?
No, that's fine. I was going to suggest exactly the final verbiage that Alderman Deuter came up with, and I think it's fair and appropriate.
Okay, I think everyone understands the motion and the intent. Any additional comments, Alderman Toledo?
Yeah, I have a procedural as it relates here, but kind of a question about how the incentive would pay out if we leave, if this motion moved forward and we leave the last bullet as distributed annually on a pay-as-you-go basis beginning January 1st, 2017, we still don't know full 2015 sales yet.
It can be made up.
Yeah.
We might get the final answer in February of 2017, but it'll be made whole. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Alderman York?
No, that's exactly right. I mean, when the redevelopment or the resolution is crafted by the attorneys and everything, we can get all the verbiage in there to cite those specific mathematical equations or whatever they are. And then to Alderman Toledo's point, we'll have to know the actual base, or we'll have to know the actual sales for either 2015 and 2016, and then do the greater than equal to or whatever to come up with that number before we do the calculation for the disbursement in 2018 of 2017's sales. Does that make sense? That makes it really clear, doesn't it? So
made a little worse, but okay. See, Alderman Toledo?
Yeah, so I have a follow-up now. So does that mean that the applicant in this case will not receive any monies in the new agreement until 2018?
Yes.
Okay. The answer is yes.
So given that, I don't think that I would be able to support that because there was a lot of discussion at committee about the applicant's need in order to have this project move forward.
I don't think the baseline, setting the baseline, and that's all we're doing here, is determining whether it's 2015 or 2016 baseline. I actually don't think the baseline changes the payout and the timing of the payout. Is that a fair statement, Alderman York?
Did I just get two different answers?
Yeah, so.
Alderman York.
Okay, so the quarterly payments will continue based on the same calculations that they are currently based on through the end of this year, which likely means the last quarterly distribution will be in April or May of 2017. Okay, and so those would be higher amounts than if we went on the new agreement right away based on the lower sales and the disruption to business. But none of these is adding any more to the total of $1.5 million. So then the second part of that equation becomes the ticker, if you will, instead of being on a quarterly distribution for 2017 sales, that'll be on an annual distribution, which will be tabulated all the way up through 2017. The incremental sales measured between the greater of 2015 or 2016 base sales times the split, the 75% split, and then that payment will be made to the applicant sometime in the first quarter to third of 2018. So they'll go almost a year without an actual payment, but they were aware of that in our discussions. The amendment solves a problem of what happens between 2016 and during the disruption in business. That's where the cash flow was impaired under the previous one. And that was what subjected them to potential financing issues.
Alderman Healy.
Okay, thank you, Mayor. I want to take a step back because I understood Alderman Deuter's motion to be nothing like that. That Alderman Deuter's motion that I seconded was just establishing an either or for the baseline, so that the baseline for the agreement is the higher of 2 years. It doesn't affect payout or timing of payout. It doesn't affect the framework of the agreement. It just makes us do an additional calculation to find out which is the higher of the bases, 2015 or 2016.
Right.
We'll have the 2015 information when it comes time to do the actual calculation. And so I'm seeing Alderman Deuter shake her head. Yes, that's all we're doing here.
You're right. I think what Alderman York was further clarifying what his amendment did to the payments, not setting the baseline. You're right. It was a little confusing there. But this is just resetting the base, figuring out whichever baseline, in this case, whichever's higher between the 2 years. But Alderman York was clarifying how the payments worked based on the amendment we just passed. But it doesn't, what Alderman Deuter motioned has nothing to do with that.
Correct. And when I heard conversation about couldn't support the amendment based on.
Well, that's why we were clarifying. So I think we're clear as we're going to get. No, I think we're clear. We're clear. Yes?
Okay.
Alderman York.
I have one final comment. So, like all the other sales tax agreements, or sales tax incentive agreements and or TIF incentive agreements, the committee will thoroughly review what the attorneys from both sides, there will be a gathering of the minds over there, and they'll come back with the actual agreement, and that will go through our committee and be scrutinized fully to make sure that it is fully understood and as we talked about this evening. Thank you.
Okay. Any additional comments as it relates to the motion to amend, second to last bullet on the last page, sales tax increment over the greater of 2015 or 2016. Any additional comments or questions? Alderman Dunn.
I originally had objections to the motion. I just thought it may have overcomplicated it, but I think it's very minor in how it would be executed. I did have also concerns how it would line up with the TIF base year. We're trying to have both of these TIF and sales tax incentives run concurrently, but I think we're okay there also because we start our evaluation in 2017 for the TIF increment using 2016 as a base year, and I don't think it's an issue of the larger of the two, 2015 or 2016 for the TIF, because we're making a big, the car dealership is making a very big investment in 2016. So had concerns initially, but I think it's a minor change, so I would support it.
Any other comments as it relates to the motion to amend to set the baseline greater of the two, 2015 or 2016? Everyone clear on what we're voting on? Clerk Spencer, I'd ask that you call the roll.
Deuter.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Levin.
Aye.
Kennedy.
Aye.
Honquist.
Aye.
Wagner.
Aye.
Mulliner.
No.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader. Absent. Dunn.
Aye.
Graham.
Aye.
Palumski.
Aye.
York.
Aye.
Toledo.
Aye.
That's 12 ayes, one nay, and one absent.
12 ayes, one nay, motion to amend carries. So we now have a report that's been amended twice. It's before council now in its final form, unless anyone else has another amendment. Any other comments? Okay, Clerk Spencer, I ask that you call the roll on the final amended report.
Ooh, let me get a sheet. I'm sorry. Would be
to be clear, that motion was to amend, not to approve the amended report. So we have to amend the approve the amendment, which we just did, and now we will approve the report in its final form.
York.
Aye.
Dunn.
Aye.
Graham.
No.
Palumski.
Aye.
Toledo.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Levin.
Aye.
Kennedy.
Aye.
Honquist.
Aye.
Wagner.
Aye.
Mulliner.
Aye.
Deuter.
Aye.
Sabatino.
Aye.
And leader is absent. So that's 12 ayes, one nays, one absent.
12 ayes, one nay. Report 7.2 as amended is approved. On to report agenda item 7.3. This is another report out of finance. Clerk Spencer, I'd ask that you read the recommendation.
It is therefore the recommendation of the Finance, Council Affairs, and Administrative Services Committee that the City Council direct the City Attorney to prepare a tax increment financing agreement between the City of Elmhurst and G&G Investments, Inc., as outlined in this report. Signed by Kevin L. York, Chairman, Bob Dunn, Vice Chairman, Noel P. Toledo, and Mark P. Sabatino.
Okay, to put this before council, I will ask for a motion to approve the report and recommendation as read. Motion by Alderman York, second by Alderman Dunn. Alderman York, your report.
Thank you, Your Honor. the report, especially in light of the one we just reviewed, is fairly clear and simple. So I'm not trying to minimize what's going on here. We met with Mr. Grimsley twice as a committee and believe that his purchase and operation of the Lens Ace Hardware store on First Avenue is going to be extremely accretive to the City of Elmhurst and its taxpayers. It also is located in a TIF district, TIF number one. It's expiring relatively soon. Like the previous applicant, Mr. Grimsley applied for 100% of the TIF increment that's going to be generated between now and the end of the TIF period, and my comments hold true and fast on any TIF incentive that even though the TIF is ending in 6 years, there's still plenty of opportunity for redevelopment in TIF 1. And I don't see where it's the right thing to do to give all of that TIF increment back to one person. I think it should benefit the entire area. We, as a committee, talked about a few numbers, and this is where we ended up, as a $25,000 pay-as-you-go, half and half, until it reaches a maximum of $25,000. There's going to be some good things happening. As the report highlights, they've been doing a diligent job of taking advantage of all the opportunities that exist within a TIF to avail themselves of help, and that's what TIFs are for, and I would ask for your support for this report. Thank you.
Okay. Comments? 11-11.
I'm having a hard time with this one, and I've looked at this as it's proceeded through. We're giving $10,000 as a business grant. We did give them the right of way. I understand their arguments. Maybe it's not worth anything. Maybe it is. If you say it's worth something, we gave it to them. They're going in for a facade grant, which could be $50,000. Potentially, that's $85,000 worth of value. I don't see that this is one that meets TIF criteria. I don't see that this is a project that wouldn't happen but for this. I don't see that it's meeting any of the two criteria. Yes, it's retaining a business, I suppose, or it's attracting a business, but I don't see any other ones. You know, sometimes a business comes to town and they say, I'd like to open up in Elmhurst, and that doesn't mean it's every business gets a TIF incentive. And that store is Ace Hardware number 2. And my understanding is it was the second Ace Hardware store ever opened. And it could be that was the last time any dollars were ever put into improving it. So when someone comes into town and looks at a tired, worn facility and makes a business deal, you'd have to know you're going to drive a bargain and say, I'm buying a building from you. It's really not in good shape, and it's going to take a ton of money to fix up. And that's where the bargain should be negotiated. Now, if the situation is it's going to take so much that you need an investment to make it happen, or we can't get that improved business, that's what TIF dollars are for. We talked about the Mazda deal and the Hyundai deal. I get that, $8 million, and I understand what kind of investment that is, and they might be ordered to go somewhere else, so that makes sense. So, yes, I understand the other argument as well. We'll get increased sales. Well, any business that comes to town and opens a new business will be increased sales. And if it makes it even more successful, they'll get increased profits too. So it just seems like, you know, for the amount of investment that I look at for this kind of business, it's not that much money, but it just rubs me the wrong way. And unless I hear something else, I just can't support this one.
Alderman Healy.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm going to take somewhat an opposite approach of my friend Alderman Levin, and those of you that know us, we're going to find that that's not that surprising. I looked at this and said I liked it because it's not an $8 million deal or a $1.5 million deal or a some of the big dollars, you know, that some of the previous TIF agreements that we've approved. And I'm very comfortable with that. I view this as an investment in a small, family-run business. Although it's an ACE, but it's owned by an individual that's in our community that I believe will lead to additional sales. Now, to Alderman Levin's point and credit, that's what all businesses are here to do. And if they don't, they close. But I look at it as, especially where that ACE is, it's in a neighborhood. And I think back to a couple of businesses in the Fifth Ward where you may have made the same argument, or somebody could have made the same argument at Brown's Chicken or TCBY. Well, those are for profit. If they don't invest in their buildings, if they don't invest in their business, they're going to go under, and, well, that's just business. And I think, well, that's what happened to those two locations. And had a previous council been given the chance to do something to help those locations, would they have? I'd like to think the answer to that question is yes. I wish we saw more of these where we had the opportunity to help smaller businesses in town succeed and prosper and improve their business in town. I'm comfortable with the dollars. I'm comfortable with the request. And see this as a benefit to that particular area, which happens to be in TIF 1, but particularly that's in a neighborhood in a family-run business and in the type of business that I think Elmhurst is known for and wants to attract, not the big boxes of, you know, Home Depot or a Lowe's or a Menards, but a neighborhood family-run ACE. I'm fully in support of that, and I think it's a wise investment for the residents of Elmhurst.
Alderman Bram.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Alderman Levin stole my thunder in regards to a lot of my comments. To me, it's not about big box, small, family-run business. It's about the TIF incentive policy that we all adopted, and it doesn't meet the criteria. I guess one of the sanity checks I would do is if $25,000 is going to make or break this redevelopment from going forward, then I don't know if it should go forward to begin with. And that's the dollar amount we're talking about here, and that's one of the criteria when we talked about this before, is, you know, what are the extraordinary costs? Yes, as Alderman Levin stated, this is about retaining a business. I think there is other financial incentives, all credit and due diligence to the business owner, property owner, for pursuing, you know, the business retail grant, the facade grant, and the right-of-way vacation. You know, you can debate that back and forth, but the hard dollars is $60,000 right there. On top of that, the land cost, you could debate it anywhere from $25,000 to into the $100,000 range. So to me, you know, is this TIF incentive necessary? I don't think so. It doesn't pass the sanity check that I have. It doesn't meet the policy requirements that we've all adopted for TIF incentives. I think the dollar amount is low, that was initially requested and that it is proposed in this report. But again, as I said about TIF 4, where it's early on in the TIF, this is at the end of the TIF and there's really no dollars left. So this similar scenario to TIF 4, but at the opposite end of the spectrum. I guess no surprise, but I can't support this. I made my statements clear when it went forward with the request for the right-of-way vacation. Some of you made mention of if the land right-of-way vacation moves forward, then there'll be higher scrutiny on the TIF incentive. I look forward to hearing additional comments on that end, and I encourage everybody not to support this.
Alderman York.
Thank you, Your Honor. I don't want to monopolize the conversation, but I feel like I owe it to this applicant, just like I did the other applicant, to fully disclose and prop them up. They are making a $1.2 million investment in the community, so it is a sizable investment when you take into consideration the purchase of the property and the business, and those documents of what all is included in that is was in our committee materials. There's site improvements of $450,000, purchase of land, $770,000, renovation of existing structure. Nothing's been done on the outside of that building for years. They're gonna get rid of some of the shadows of things that have been there. They're gonna leave the owl up there, which is good. They're gonna make a serious investment into this property. So $1.2 million, I think about over $400,000 of it was TIF qualified. They've asked for a TIF incentive of $25,000. I fully support the committee's report on this and ask for everybody's assistance, and I just wanted to make certain that we gave this applicant its fair trial. Thank you.
Alderman Deuter.
Thank you, Mayor. You know, I think in Alderman Levin's comments, he touched on something that I think is relates to this and relates to other TIF deals that we've looked at, and that's that there was an acquisition involved in this. If there is a gap in a proposed project, I think the first place to look to try and close that gap is in your acquisition price. And if you can't make the deal work, then you should be trying to acquire the property for less. And I would rather have that private transaction be where those dollars are made up, as opposed to us coming in, the city coming in behind, and not even behind, but being perceived as being willing to step in and fill any gap that exists. So I appreciate Alderman Levin's comments that you know, there was a purchase in there and that the state of the property, the need for improvements should have been kind of really hit hard at the acquisition time and not left a gap for the city to come in behind and fill. So I despite, you know, I know the committee worked hard to move this dollar amount down, but this, you know, it's not something I'm gonna support.
Alderman Plomsky.
I have a question about the facade grant. Just want clarification that will be an application that goes through the building department and will be decided upon by the building department, and then will that be sent to committee or just?
It's not sent to committee.
Okay.
It's just a set of criteria and a set of qualifying expenses.
Okay.
And I don't believe that this tax ID number, whatever you want to call it, parcel number has ever applied for a facade grant.
I don't believe so.
Okay. That's why they're eligible.
Correct.
Let me see if Alderman.
Okay.
Is that it, Alderman Plofsky?
Then I just wanted to say that I've struggled with this one too, but I think it reminds me of a property we talked about on Addison where, you know, there was a variance that allowed for, well, there are plans for more sales, and I feel like there have been some advantages and some tools available because of the TIF and our grant program, and we just approved the vacation of the property. I think that we are assisting them. I really want them to succeed, and I feel comfortable with what we've done so far and the anticipated facade improvement, but I don't know if this is a necessary assistance for them. Thank you.
Well, I'm done.
This particular project, I feel like we're being ultra critical of the applicant because their request is fairly modest compared to maybe our previous discussion. Yeah, it's only $25,000. Is it? Will they move forward without it? Probably. But what we have is a vastly improved property. It's $1.2 million for the renovation. It's also $800,000 for the land acquisition. You have a lot of small requests, and this is a modest business owner that it's a family-run business that has been around for decades. They're going to make a very nice investment, a pretty large improvement to that property to continue to make it viable because in its current state, I don't know if it would be viable going forward. And I just believe that it's a quality project for that particular area, and it will help with, you know, continue to revitalize our downtown. As far as extraordinary expenses, I don't know if it came out it's not in the report, but there is an oil tank buried in the parking lot in the backyard, which has to be removed and mitigated. There is an expense that they're going to have to deal with. But it's, in my opinion, it's a good project. It's a modest request to a business that's going to grow and prosper in the community. And I believe we should support businesses like these that are making reasonably large investments relative to the size of their entity, and actually asking for pretty modest help from the city. Thanks.
Alderman Levin.
Well, first of all, I think it's a great project. I'm glad they're coming here. I'm supportive of the business grant. I've supported the right of way, and if a facade grant comes through, I think it's appropriate. But we have TIF criteria, and one of them is that TIF assistance will not be provided to projects that have the financial feasibility to proceed without the benefit of the assistance. Prior to the TIF request, the city may undertake an independent analysis of the project cost to ensure that the request for assistance is necessary. This is, to me, like when someone comes in and says, I'm going to buy a $1 million house, and you go to the closing and they say, well, something isn't working and it's going to cost $5,000 to fix, and we're going to walk away from the house. I mean, yeah, it's a family-run business. I think Bloomberg's a family-run business, too, if I remember correctly. So this is a sophisticated group, family group, that owns four hardware stores, and I'm not belittling them. I think they're great hardware stores. I think their store in Addison is probably the best hardware store I've ever been in my life. I mean, they got experts, they got all the inventory, but this is not a amount of money like someone opening on Spring Road in the Fifth Ward who needs to just get enough money to make it. This isn't make it or break it money. This is just throw us a bone here, give us a little extra money. They don't need it. They don't need it to succeed. They're going to do it anyway. And so when you say it's modest, okay, but it's still city money. It's we're giving it away for no reason other than it's a modest request. This, there's not a gift policy here. This is the TIF policy. So and if I heard something different that put me the other way, I'd be happy to change my mind, but I just don't see it. And, you know, only $25,000, no justification whatsoever.
Okay. Any new comments? Seeing none, I'll ask Clerk Spencer to call the roll.
York.
Aye.
Dunn.
Aye.
Graham.
No.
Belumsky.
No.
Toledo.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Levin.
No.
Kennedy.
Aye.
Conquest.
Aye.
Wagner.
Aye.
Mulliner.
Aye.
Deuter.
No.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader absent. That's 1, 2. Yeah, 9 ayes, 4 nays, 1 absent.
9 ayes, 4 nays, motion carries. Agenda item 7.3 is approved. Okay, on to reports and recommendations. 8.1, Mayor Morley, that's me. York Commons, stormwater project update. Try to keep this short as it's 9:45, but I want to give an update, not only for council, but anyone in the audience who is not familiar with what's happened. So we have a York Commons project that council and various committees have been considering and pushing for stormwater mitigation for the last couple of years. I'll remind council that the original proposal from the city was to utilize York Commons in two separate areas, an east lobe and a west lobe, which would have accommodated 23 acre feet in a 100 year event. I'll remind council that the Public Works Committee, in considering all of our what I'll call projects, has set a threshold of 100 year events to mitigate up to 100 years. Original proposal was for 23 acre feet at York Commons. That would have helped homes on Crescent, Washington, and Cayuga. The Park District rejected the East Lobe, the largest part of the project's approximately 17 acre feet. What we're discussing right now is the West Lobe only. The West Lobe, as proposed, will accommodate 10 acre feet. The question is whether or not a shutoff valve be included in the project. Park District is insisting that a shutoff valve be included. Council, as council will recall, made a motion to amend the IGA to remove the requirement of the valves. It is of the opinion of our engineer, Christopher Burke Engineering, who has presented before this committee or before this council, that a valve is not necessary. So after this council made a motion and reconsidered and had numerous conversations, council rejected the use of the valve. Park District insisted that the valve stay. There's numerous reasons why I believe City Council wanted to reject the valve. Cost, adding the complexity of a mechanical issue that didn't need to be there, among other things. We did hear from the Park District at one of our meetings that they were concerned of what happens in a 500 year event. To put that in perspective, that's the chances of an event happening of 0.2% in a century. But they were very, very interested in what would happen in the 0.2% if that did happen during a century. The way the project was designed and recommended by Burke was that it would operate very similar to the quarry, in that when it fills up, it would overflow in a low point. You actually create this dish and you notch out one corner a little bit, and when it fills up, it overflows in a directed route. In this case, the recommendation was for it to overflow onto York Street and south. During a 500-year event, Burke tells us that even if it did overflow, in so many words, it's a 500-year event, everyone's wet already, and there's no incremental impact to anybody downstream. Park District insisted otherwise, so City Manager Grabowski and I penned a letter on January 26th asking for further clarification from the Park District. We asked them four questions. Question number one, does the stormwater project, I'll paraphrase, does the stormwater project as presented meet all county ordinances for a 100-year rainfall event? Question number two was, because the Park District was concerned about a 500-year event, one option of not including the valve was to allow the city to dig one extra foot deeper, and according to Burke, that would alleviate even the fears that the Park District had with the 500-year event. So question number two was, what does your engineer think of the proposal to solve your concern with digging deeper versus putting in a valve? Question number three is, is the shutoff valve necessary? Question number four, if a valve is necessary, please have your engineers tell us why they think it's necessary. So, Park District met last Wednesday, and we did not have enough time to listen to what the Park District said, digest it, and get anything on the agenda for this evening. But the Park District did send us a response, and I'll paraphrase V3's response to our four questions. Does the project meet DuPage County Stormwater Floodplain Ordinance? Yes. Based on the review, would the 500-year option that we're proposing, which is dig a foot deeper, would that solve the problems? Burke's answer is not enough data to provide an answer. I'm sorry. Burke was clear on their answer. V3 said not enough data to provide an answer. Question number three, is a valve necessary for this project? V3's answer is, well, in a really bad rainstorm, it'll overflow, and if you have a valve, it'll stop that. Didn't answer the question as to whether or not the valve was needed, just that kind of opined how a valve worked. Question number four, is V3 stating that the valve is a requirement? V3 has not proposed any modeling and did not answer the question. So that's what the letter says. I would encourage every council member, every elected official, and any resident who is interested to please listen to the Park Board's last meeting, starting at minute 33 of the meeting, and it runs about 40 minutes. You'll get an earful about their logic on how they want to move forward with this. That having been said, I can tell you this. Regardless of how they reach their conclusion, the Park Board is adamant in their demand for a valve. So the ball is back in our court as to whether or not we want to put this forward. I should note for the audience and for council members, at no time has the city stopped in its engineering planning. At no time have we told Burke Engineering to stop in their planning for this project. We are not at a point now, but we are at a point very soon where any delay could delay the project that's planned to go in this spring. But we have an opportunity now to address it. That having been said, how do we do this from a procedural standpoint? Well, according to our code, we're allowed to have a motion to reconsider on any item that was discussed during a meeting or in the meeting immediately following. So, as council will recall, At our last meeting, we approved resolution R-134-2015. So it is within our code and within our rules to allow us to reconsider that approval. When you reconsider, you have to have a change and you have to be on the prevailing side. Well, the good news is, I think it passed 13-0 or maybe 14-0. So there's plenty of people here on the prevailing side. But to further clarify, this is how, and I've discussed this with Don Storino, this is how we would put this before council for what I would consider a final discussion. When we get to other business, I will be asking someone on council for a motion to reconsider this resolution. Part of that motion to reconsider, I will be asking for, is to replace or put back in the original language as it pertains to the valve language. Okay? Now.
Wait, point of order?
Yes.
I guess two questions in my point of order. One, can you do a motion to reconsider on a resolution?
Yes.
And two, can you do an amendment to what was actually passed? My understanding was that you would be reconsidering only that of which what was passed previously.
No, a motion to reconsider by its nature actually has a change in it. So, yes, you can motion to reconsider a resolution, and a motion to reconsider, there's nothing to reconsider if you don't change any part of the report. So, that having been said, or no reason to reconsider it if there is no change. I will be asking for a motion to reconsider under other business for this resolution. I will also ask that motion to reconsider, add the valve language back in that has previously been removed. We can certainly have conversation on it at that time, but it's a little bit late. I'm also going to recommend after that motion to reconsider, that is allowed by our code, that we postpone to a certain day, which will be 2 weeks and a day, right? We have a President's Day?
Correct.
So I'm going to be asking after that motion to reconsider, I'm going to be asking for council to pass a motion to postpone to a certain day so that we can have a full and final conversation. What's the date?
16th.
The 16th of this month. While not necessarily required, we might run into some Open Meeting Act issues where if we make a decision this evening on something that wasn't on the agenda, even though it follows our code, we might run afoul of the Open Meetings Act. So because we did not post this motion to reconsider, that's what I'm going to be asking folks to do. That's as it relates to York Commons. As far as a general update, I would say, I'm going to do this again, I will encourage every elected official up here to listen to the last Park District meeting and see what was discussed. Just a brief history as it relates to the Park District. We have five projects among, I think, 10 or 11 that Burke Engineering has proposed. We have five projects that include the Park District. The sum total of those five projects is actually less than 2% of all Park District land. Originally, we were asking for shared use at no cost. Some of the land is restricted by DNR grants. However, I will remind council that I personally met with the director of the IDNR, Patty Bellock, and other members of the DNR, and they were open to the city of Elmhurst coming together, Park District and the city, and jointly approaching the IDNR and allowing use of their land at no charge. At this point, the Park District is not considering allowing the residents of Elmhurst to use their own land at no charge for this stormwater mitigation. Pending before Public Works is the next project after York Commons, and that is Golden Meadows. The offer from the Park District on Golden Meadows, as stated in their November 19th memorandum from Jim Rogers to Jim Grabowski, is the Park District is asking for a multiplier of 1.5 or 150% of the appraised value. So instead of approaching the DNR, which is an option to allow us to use the land for free, they are asking us to pay for and purchase the land at 1.5 times the value of that property. In addition, they're also asking for the remaining three projects, that same codicil, they're asking for us to purchase the land from them at 1.5 times the value. We do have a pending request into them since they have stated that the three remaining projects at Crestview, East End, and Wild Meadows Trace are passive green space and will remain passive green space. We have a standing request into them as to not charge us 1.5 times the value, but just allow us to use it. We don't have a response from them at this point. That's my update in general as it relates to York Commons. As I said, under other business, I will be asking for council's cooperation on motion to reconsider that resolution. And ultimately, 2 weeks from now, 2 weeks and a day, allow us to have final vote conversation. Not only will it be on the agenda, but it will allow residents to come and speak and offer their opinion as we consider that one final time. And that's it as it relates to my York Commons report. Any questions as it relates to York Commons before I move on? Alderman Levin.
When that motion occurs, is it your intent that it will not be debated? It'll just be to get the reconsideration locked in so that the full, that all of the debate will occur on the 16th?
You know, I talked to City Attorney Storino about it. Certainly we can have a conversation if we want tonight at 9:59. But we'll certainly will be discussing it. So if someone has comments or cleanup, but ultimately, no decision, no vote will be called tonight. I would recommend that the majority of the conversation happen 2 weeks from now for the residents. But also, I know this is something for Alderman to consider right now, and I want to give Alderman an opportunity to discuss as well, or to think about over the next 2 weeks. Alderman Bram.
Thank you, sir. I do have concerns with Mayor, you making a request for a motion to reconsider. I would think the more efficient and a better way to get this out to the public would be to have this on the Public Works agenda for next committee meeting, and then a report coming out, if so choose, from that committee for the next council meeting. It serves the same purpose, better overall communication from the council as a whole to the public on what is being done. And like I've already initially said, I have concerns over the process of utilizing motion to reconsider in this issue.
Okay. Well, I respectfully disagree. I can't think of any more conversation, any new information that's going to come this way, and quite frankly, I'm not up for any delay of getting this answer out to the residents of Elmhurst, and it's well within our code. Any other comments or questions? All right, that's it for my York Commons stormwater project update. I did not have an opportunity. I see him in the audience. I want to thank Chris Craigle. Chris, please identify yourself. Recently retired, over 31 years in service to the city of Elmhurst, and I was unable to attend his retirement party, and I want to thank him for all of his hard work. Thank you very much. Okay, City Manager Grabowski.
Thank you, and along those lines, you noticed tonight on the consent agenda, the council approved appointment of the interim chief, Bill Anishevitz, and I appreciate your support on that. Of course, the reason that we need that is because Jeff Bassiter will be retiring this Friday with similar service as Mr. Craigle, over 30 years. I bring that up to say thank you publicly at the City Council meeting, but also to remind everyone that Friday at 3:00, we'll be having a little ceremony here for Jeff that is open to the public. So I would invite and encourage everyone to come and say thank you to Jeff for his years of service.
Okay, any other reports? Alderman Dunn.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just a bit of positive news. We had a meeting with the FAA here a few months ago talking about the runway restructuring and the O'Hare modernization project. And we know there was a runway added or activated in October, and we were wondering what the impact of that was to Elmhurst, and just went on the Chicago Department of Aviation site today and got some some information on that, and the runway that was added, 10R, came on board middle of October, I believe, and the particular runway that impacts Elmhurst 4R that points right at us, impacts the north side of town generally. The takeoffs off of that runway were 38% in August and 32% of all the takeoffs from O'Hare in September. Dropped to 22% in August after the new runway opened. And then in November, it was down to 20% of all takeoffs on that particular runway, which that tends to be a bit of a aggravation for some of the residents in Elmhurst. So just seems like the new runway that opened did have a positive impact in to the residents of Elmhurst so far. Thanks.
Okay. Any other reports? Alderman Kennedy.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just wanted to highlight a committee report that was reviewed at Public Works last week. We city staff went back and looked at the stormwater projects that were completed in 2015 as some of the new policies that we put in place. I just want to give some highlights on those. In 2015, there were 126 new homes constructed. Each one of them did on-site detention. The cumulative above that was 1.21 acre feet. In terms of existing homes, there were 490 permits issued for various projects. About half of those had increases to net impervious. And on average, each one of those homes have put 40 cubic feet of storage in there. We have a residential stormwater management incentive program. This is for people who want to do things to improve the drainage issues in on their properties. This used to be just rear yard drains, but now this includes some on-site detention. We had 14 homes do that as well. And then in terms of city-owned parking lots, and different developments, we put detention at York and Palmer Drive across from Francesca's. The Addison parking deck has half of acre foot storage beneath it, and the Hahn Street development will have 0.17 acre feet. All told, that brings us to 2.38 acre feet of storage from 2015. Memory serves me, in 2014 we were somewhere around 1.6. So in the course of 2 years, we will have stored 4 acre feet in areas that we didn't have policies, we didn't have procedures to do that. And as we continue to have homes be replaced and do more and more projects, we're probably going to be on average of somewhere around 2 acre feet per year that we're going to be creating for on-site detention with these projects. So not only is it important that we're doing the projects with park districts and schools and county and other entities, it's important that we continue to do what we're doing here, because it's just going to make a greater difference year over year as we continue to have these policies. Thank you.
Any other reports? Alderman Bram.
Thank you. Two things. One, to tail off of Alderman Dunn's comments in regards to O'Hare and how it impacts Elmhurst. I believe it was a day or two ago where Mayor Emanuel announced, I don't know what his exact terminology was, groundbreaking landmark deal with O'Hare to expand terminals, to add the final runway, and I'm not sure what else was included in that landmark deal stated by Mayor Emanuel. So I think we need to continue to keep our eye on the ball on what's going on with O'Hare and make sure that our voice is continued to be heard to represent the City of Elmhurst residents on that front. The other request is in regards to an economic development report. I've had some conversations with staff via email over the past couple of weeks, or if not month, over some of the main developments that have been going on in the city. I don't know if city manager, I know it's late in the hour, if you would mind those that you have a status on speaking one or two sentences on each of these, being Hahn Street, Wilder Crossing, the former Plass Building, what I believe is the proposed FFC or the Elmhurst parking lot, the retail space at the Addison Garage, the Paragon development, and
Alderman Bram, hold on a second. Can you back up? I have Hahn, Wilder Crossing, Plass, FFC,
Addison Garage retail space, Paragon Development, an announcement, and I don't think there's any impact here, but if the city could speak to it, the sale of the Mariano's land, not of Mariano's. Well, I guess Mariano's was sold, but in this case, the land in Elmhurst was sold that Mariano sits on, if there's any impact or concern there. And then the former residential building close to York and Grand, right next to the bank and Wendy's, which I believe started demolition.
What was that last one? I missed it.
It was a former residential building next to Wendy's, and I believe the bank.
The north side of Wendy's?
Correct.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Any informal updates tonight would be appreciated, and I would like to request a more formal update on these as well as other economic developments in the city of Elmhurst at a later date.
Let me give you what I can. Pond Street, off and running, and they plan to have people in the fall. Marketing should start in the next month. Wilder Crossing, that program, that's that project that's on Addison across the street and a little bit north of Fitz's. That development is indefinitely on hold due to market. Plass is being torn down, and it's moving forward with the development with retail on first floor and condominiums on the next two.
Office on the second.
Office
floor.
On the second.
Condominiums on the third.
Condominiums on the third. Construction, continued construction this year. FFC, we're going back and forth with the owner on the IGA. We're having productive.
RDA.
Having productive conversations with them. Anticipate something for council to review within the next month. Addison lease, that's private negotiation. They tell us stuff is coming, but they're not willing to tell us what. But they said they're getting down to the final strokes. Orange Theory's in, as you're aware, around the corner. They're obviously actively pursuing tenants and say they're close, but that's what they've told us so far. Paragon, north of Wendy's, and I can't read my writing.
Mariano's land sale?
Mariano's. I think that's, you want to report on that next time, or do you have any questions?
I'd like to talk with Alderman Bram about what you're looking for on the Mariano sale. Yes, the land sold.
Just confirming that I believe there's no impact in regards to the land sale, but I just want to confirm that the city has not heard any impact on that as well.
Correct, no impact.
And then we can get more detailed follow-up next meeting, all right?
One follow-up on that.
Anything. Yeah.
One of the reasons I ask is because we do have a lot going on in the city, and I think it would be good to communicate that maybe next time in a more formal manner on where these projects are and where they're headed. You know, sales tax, we talk about a lot tonight, and I think it's good to know what potential sales tax businesses are coming in town. The other thing is I've been hearing a lot of talk of some of these developments, one of which being Han, moving from apartments to condos. And I want to make sure I squash any of these rumors in the, you know, early in the time frame compared to waiting until they continue to build and gain momentum. So if we could move forward with both of those aspects of economic development, that would be appreciated.
Okay. Any other reports? Seeing none, we're going to move on to resolution agenda item 9.1. Clerk Spencer, I'd ask that you read.
A resolution to approve and authorize the execution of an actuarial report services agreement by and between Lauterbach and Amen LLP and the City of Elmhurst for Police and Fire Pension Fund actuarial reports.
Okay, to put this before council, I ask for an approval of the resolution as read. Motion by Alderman York, second by Alderman Dunn. Alderman York?
Thank you. This pertains to agenda item 6.14 on the consent agenda, which is a report requesting the switch of professional services for actuarial services on pension funds. This resolution is required tonight to allow the new actuaries to perform an actuarial evaluation of the pension funds to be included in the 2015 comprehensive annual financial report on a timely basis. Thank you.
Okay, any additional comments or questions? Clerk Spencer, I'd ask that you call the roll.
York.
Aye.
Gunn.
Aye.
Graham.
Aye.
Polumsky.
Aye.
Toledo.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Levin.
Aye.
Kennedy.
Aye.
Honquist.
Aye.
Wagner.
Aye.
Mulliner.
Aye.
Deuter.
Aye.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader absent. 13 ayes, 0 nays, 1 absent.
13 ayes, 0 nays, motion carries. On to agenda item 9.2. Clerk Spencer, I'd ask that you read the resolution.
A resolution choosing to receive unbilled natural gas from NICOR as consideration for use of public rights of way in the city of Elmhurst, DuPage, and Cook Counties, Illinois.
Okay, to put this before council, I'll ask for a motion to approve the resolution as read. Motion by Alderman York, second by Alderman Dunn. Alderman York.
Thank you, Your Honor. This resolution is a result of the resolution passed earlier tonight in agenda item 6.19 and is required from a parliamentary procedure perspective, say that three times fast at this time of night, because this resolution requires that a franchise agreement be in place before the election of the method of consideration for said franchise agreement. That's it. Thank you.
Comments or questions? Clerk Spencer.
York.
Aye.
Dunn.
Aye.
Graham.
Aye.
Polumsky.
Aye.
Toledo.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Kennedy.
Aye.
Honquist.
Aye.
Wagner.
Aye.
Did I leave out Levin?
He doesn't remember.
Levin. And Wagner, okay. Mulliner.
Aye.
Deuter.
Aye.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader absent. 13 ayes, 0 nays, 1 absent.
13 ayes, 0 nays. Agenda item 9.2 is approved. On to other business. As a follow-up to my report, as I stated, after talking with City Attorney Storino, this was the best and quickest way to get this question back before council, get an answer to the residents as quickly as possible. Therefore, I am requesting that someone on the council make a motion to reconsider resolution R-134-2015 with the valve language back in. Motion to reconsider by Alderman Levin, second by Alderman Honquist. Comments or questions? Alderman Bram?
I'll just restate my point of order. I don't believe we could change utilizing motion of reconsider. What I proposed was doing in the committee and having come back to council in 2 weeks, the same intent that the motion to reconsider would achieve. Due to the procedural issue, I cannot support this.
Okay, I'm not gonna ask for a vote. I'm gonna ask for a motion to postpone to date certain or certain day, which is our next meeting, which is the
16th.
Motion to postpone or motion to postpone until date certain, which to the 16th. Motion by Alderman Honquist, second by Alderman Levin. All right.
We have to vote on that.
That's debatable just on the date, not on anything else. Anybody have anything to say about that? Seeing none, I'll ask Clerk Spencer to call the roll on motion to postpone to certain day.
Honquist.
Aye.
Levin.
Aye.
Kennedy.
Aye.
Wagner.
No.
Okay, Mulliner.
No.
Okay, Deuter.
Aye.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader is absent. Dunn.
Aye.
Graham.
No.
Polumsky.
Aye.
York.
Aye.
Toledo.
Aye.
Healy.
No.
Get everybody, it looks like. Okay, 9 ayes, 4 nays, 1 absent.
9 ayes, 4 nays, Motion carries. We'll be discussing that on February 16th. Any other business? Alderman Healy.
Thank you, Mayor. Just for the record, if Bloomberg were to choose to relocate to Elmhurst, I would happily support a TIF request, and in fact, I'd write it myself.
Noted.
The check?
Let us know how that works. Alderman York.
Thank you, Your Honor. Either I didn't get out in front of it enough, but on Thursday, February 11th, the Elmhurst Memorial Hospital Foundation is having its annual Chef Fest. It's a Drury Lane. It starts at 6 o'clock. It's a great event. Supports all the work that the hospital does in the community, providing services for those who can't afford them. So I would highly recommend that you look into obtaining a ticket and going to Chef Fest. It's a lot of fun. Thank you.
Any other business? Alderman Kennedy.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. You made an earlier suggestion for everyone to listen to the Park District meeting from last week. After you've done that, I'd suggest you reach out to anyone on the park board that you know and have them explain to you the logic in their vote, because I'm not really sure they have any logic in their vote. So thank you very much.
Okay. Any other business? Motion to adjourn. Motion by Alderman York, second by Alderman Honquist. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We're adjourned.